Okay, so approach to medlung deformity. Now, why I chose this topic? Recently, we came across a child, a girl, adolescent girl with medlung deformity, and my fellow asked me different questions that whether we should treat or we can watch, when to treat, what treatment should be done, should we address radius only, or we should do shortening of ulna. So there are a lot of questions, and actually I know that there is very clear-cut approach to medlung, and based on my experience and based on some papers which are published worldwide, which are very good papers. So I thought, let me discuss this topic once, and then you all will have the approach to this patients, and you will know what to do when such patient comes to you. So Otto Medlung is the person who coined this term in 1878. He found this deformity for the first time. We know that it is more common in females, and it's a kind of mesomelic dwarfism. Mesomelia means the forearm and the tibia or the leg part is short, and it's a part of Leri-Weill dyschondrosteosis. So it's kind of skeletal dysplasia and then an association. Actually, it's a triad of short stature, mesomelia, and Medlung's deformity. So when these three things are existing together, this makes Leri-Weill dyschondrosteosis. The key pathophysiology is an abnormal or tight volar radial unit ligament. And you will see, this is a pathognomonic sign of Medlung, that you will see a depression in the distal ulnar side of the radius. And this is the site where the Vickers ligament or volar radial unit ligament inserts. So whenever you operate upon this children, you will see this ligament is attaching here, and it makes a depression at this point, which is very clearly visible on X-ray. And this differentiates a Medlung from what's known as Medlung-like deformities. So this is a pathognomonic sign of Medlung disease. Now the question is whether egg came first or the hen. So the question is whether Vickers ligament produces dyschondrosteosis and underlying physis gets sick and leading to deformity, or dyschondrosteosis is existing before, and due to the deformity Vickers ligament gets secondarily tight. So that's a question. But we know that dyschondrosteosis has a systemic affection like short stature, short forearms. The patients with idiopathic Medlungs, their forearm lengths are they are not very short, but those with the skeletal dysplasia, their overall stature is short, and their forearm lengths are also short. If you check the tibias, they are shorter compared to the thigh segment. Now, what happens is when this Vickers ligament is tight, it gets contracted, and because of that, the ulnar volar side of radial physis gets contracted, and that leads to increased growth from the radial side and from the dorsal side, leading to a volar angulation, and there is growth reduction from the radius that leads to a relative more growth of ulna, and that leads to ulnocarpal ulnocarpal crowding at times, leading to different restriction of extension or painful range of wrist motion. If you see on the volar side again, as this ligaments becomes tight, the radius starts bowing like this, and due to that, ulna keeps on protruding from the top, and there is a dorsal angulation, the dorsal prominence that happens in typical Medlungs. So it leads to a progressive deformity. Most of the girls, they present somewhere between 10 to 12 years of age. But the parents, if they are very observant, they would come earlier than that. And then you can find out this sign and you can treat them early. But most of the Indian population, I have seen them presenting to us after 10 years. And by the time they are approaching us, their deformities are progressed already. They have prominence of ulna, as you can see here. This is a case of bilateral medlar. The ulnar tip is prominent, and that cosmetic appearance brings them to the doctors rather than the pain and the restricted range of motion. If you do an MRI, you will see this side of the ulnar side of radial physis is sick. It gets prematurely closed, and sometimes you can also see the radiolunate ligament. Some of these patients can also have radiotraqueteal ligament, which also needs release during surgery. So presenting complaints are three. The prominent ulnar bump is the main complaint, occasional wrist pain, and restricted movement. Their dorsiflexion and supination are usually restricted. So these are the three presenting complaints. Now, there are radiological types of Madelung disease explained by Zibala from, and there's a nice article from Journal of Hand Surgery. The one is the typical distal radius type, where we see changes of a change in the distal radial metaphysis, as we can see, and there is no other skeletal change. The another is a entire radius type, and this entire radius type is more associated with the typical skeletal dysplasia or Leriwell dyschondrosteosis, where you can see some periosteal reaction and some bone formation along the interosseous membrane, along the diaphysis of radius. And typically the radiocapitellar distance is more than 4 millimeters. Usually this distance is less than 4 millimeters in adolescence. So these two are the signs along with the short forearms. And these are usually bilateral cases. So whenever you see this bilateral affection with the whole radius involved, these patients have high chances of progressing to wrist arthritis despite of your treatment. So you have to explain that to the family at the outset. So entire radius type is a more difficult problem to treat because it is morphologically more severe disease. The third type is what's known as reverse Madelung deformity, where instead of dorsal bump, you will see a volar bump. And these patients have anomalous dorsal radiolunate ligament. And if you have an opportunity to operate upon these patients, you have to go through volar approach, and then you can pass your mixture dorsally to release this ligament. And the moment you release this ligament, you will see the radiolunate joint very clearly on your IITV. So reverse Madelung is typically will produce a volar bump rather than radial bump, and the ulna has tendency of sinking in rather than jetting out on the dorsal side. So these are three radiologic types described by Zibala. Now recently we had seen a child where there was coexisting Madelung and reverse Madelung in a same lady. So this is a 12-year-old girl, and you can see on left side there is typical Madelung where the ulna has jet out dorsally. But on right side, there is reverse Madelung where ulna is sinking on the volar side. And there is a palmar, there is a radiological sign of the volar radiolunate ligament here. But here you can see the anomalous dorsal radiolunate ligament sign, and there is changes on this side. So again, you can see this combination can also exist. Madelung on one side and reverse Madelung on the other side. Now, what are the radiologic parameters of severity of disease? Now, as the distal radius is pathologic or abnormal, we cannot use parameters where we take the basic parameter from radius. So, ulna has been found normal in this patient. So, we take normal ulna as a reference point. So, ulnar tilt is a first a parameter where the radius get inclined towards ulna. And with this inclination of radius, the carpals get triangulated, or carpals get sunken, or what's known as pyramidalization. So you have to draw a line to the articular surface of distal radius and draw a straight line from the ulna. The angle is which is made is termed as ulnar tilt, and the ulnar tilt more than 30 degrees is severe tilt. If it remains untreated, it may lead to osteoarthritis. The other is Lunet subsidence. Now, Boston Group has used this parameter of making surgical decisions. How it is measured? You draw a line, a vertical line through the distal ulna, and from the articular surface of ulna, you draw a horizontal line. The distance of lunate below this horizontal line is termed as a lunate subsidence, and lunate subsidence more than 4.5 millimeter is considered as significant and it warrants correction or ulnar shortening. So we'll come discuss that later. The third thing is Palmar carpal displacement. So Palmar carpal displacement, again you have to draw a vertical line and see the most bowler surface of lunate and the distance between these two, and more the distance is more severe variety. Ulnar variance is also discussed in some papers, but when this distal radius is deformed, at times ulnar variance measurement becomes difficult. So these three parameters are the parameters of severity, and we'll see that how we can utilize this in our decision making. Now, one should also be aware of Madelung-like deformities, and this will produce a similar clinical appearance as we see in typical Madelung. And one is multiple hereditary exostosis related ulnar shortening leading to a pseudo cubitus varus. And here you will see the similar kind of clinical picture, but presence of an osteochondroma along the ulna and short ulna is a representing sign of it having multiple hereditary exostosis. Sometimes we see that distal radius is fixed with K wires and there is growth arrest of the lateral radial physis, which can lead to ulnar prominence and radial shortening. So again, that is post-traumatic Madelung, and this is not typical Madelung. In both this situation, you will not see a cleft on the medial and volar side of radius, which we typically see in Madelung deformity. Now let's discuss some cases, and that's how we will learn the approach of Madelung deformity treatment. This 9.5 years old girl presented with the ulnar prominence at rest. She doesn't have any significant pain, or cosmetically also she is not much concerned, but restriction of terminal dorsiflexion and supination is worrisome. And this is the X-ray. You can see the ulnar radial ulnar inclination is around 40 degrees, and the ulna is little bit more advanced than radius. So this younger than 12 years, we prefer to just resect the vicus ligament and we do the physiolysis. Physiolysis means the most ulnar side of radial growth plate is drilled or burred, and that the bar which is formed is broken. You don't need to put any fat interposition. You can just take a small bit of fat and put it there. But key thing is to release the vicus ligament. If they have approached to you before 10, 12 years, resecting the vicus ligament, you can reverse the growth. So volar approach is taken, pamaris longus is retracted laterally, and median nerve is retracted medially. You will see the pronator teres and pronator quadratus, sorry, and you have to release the pronator quadratus from the radial side of the radius from here, and you have to reflect the whole pronator quadratus, and then you will see this structure, and this is the vicus ligament. This goes from the radius to the lunate, and once you put your artery or mixture underneath it, confirm on image intensifier like this, and then you can cut this vicus ligament. So here we have cut the ligament, and with this you can dorsiflex the wrist, and you can see this is separating out more, and immediately on image intensifier you will find the distance between the lunate and radius has increased. So that is a sign that you have completely excised or resected the ligament. Sometimes if your ligament resection is not complete, you will see there's radial lunate are still overlapping and you are not able to see them completely. So cut it completely, and then you take your burr or a small burr and locate the most medial part of physis. Just burr it out and put a small fat graft, and you are done with the surgery. So this is preoperative, and this is 5 months follow up, and this is 18 months follow up. You can see this this part is progressing proximally, and ulna has now radial ulnar deformity has corrected and the inclination has improved. So this kind of improvement can be seen in younger children. And for younger children, we can just perform vicus ligament resection and physiolysis. Now, this paper, which was published in 1992 by Beakers, they had 11 patients, and out of them, 10 were girls. And most patients presented for pain and 3 for cosmesis, average age of 12 years, and 12 wrists out of 15 shown halt in progression of the disease. So their deformity did not progress, and pain reduced, and range of motion also improved, while 3 patients required radial osteotomy. So the question is, which are these 3 patients which would require radial osteotomy? So we have tried to study that in more details, but most of the children, when they are below 12 years, you did this procedure, and most of them, they don't need further intervention. The problem is, most of the patients in our setup, they come after 12 years. So they are in the advanced form of deformity. So let's see this second girl, 12 years old, right ulnar prominence, pain on writing and restricted terminal motion. And here you can see that ulna is quite advanced. It is crowding with the carpals, and certainly this will give her pain. And ulna is projecting dorsally, and the dorsal angular deformity is existing in the distal radius. Lunette subsidence is more than 5.5 millimeter, and ulnar tilt is 60 degrees. So this shows that there is a gross deformity. Although child is skeletally not mature, she is premenarchal. What we did after resecting the Vickers ligament, we performed a dome osteotomy of radius and did distal ulnar epiphyseodesis, because she has a couple of years growth left. We were thinking that if distal ulna stops growing, then at the end, the ulna would lie at a satisfactory position. Now, this is a smiley osteotomy, and then it was fixed with cross K-wires, and then the distal, the precautions which we should take while doing this osteotomy is very important to understand, and I have burnt my fingers for a couple of times, and so I thought, let me put this slides. Many a times we end up doing very distal osteotomy. So there is very small metaphyseal fragment of radius is available. So avoid very distal and osteotomy. Keep it bit proximal so that you can have a good purchase of your wire. Let's say in this case, my osteotomy was so low that my wire purchase was a problem. The second thing is, after making multiple drill holes, you do not complete the osteotomy, but put your wire still the osteotomy site first. As we do in pubitus varus, keep your wires in, and once you correct it, then drive the wires home. Similarly, you keep your wires inserted before completion of osteotomy, because once you complete the osteotomy, it's like a video game. It's sometimes difficult to negotiate the wires from a place where you want it to be. And when you pass your wire in the distal fragment, keep wires parallel to the lateral cortex, because if you put a wire in center, then it will not have good purchase in the proximal fragment. What I mean is, you see this wire, this should be parallel to the lateral cortex, then it will have some purchase in the proximal fragment. If your wire is going this way in the center of distal radius, it will not have good purchase in the proximal fragment. So this is an important thing to learn. For this, you might have to start from the styloid process itself. So start from there, and then you can have a good hold. The third thing is, when you are dealing with a typical Madelung, your osteotomy should open volarly. And when you are doing a reverse Madelung, your osteotomy should open dorsally, because there is a dorsal apex for the Madelung and the volar apex for the reverse Madelung. So this is a case of reverse Madelung. You see, I have opened up on the dorsal side so that the distal fragment would align nicely with the proximal fragment. And so I've tried to use this Ellis plate or locking plate sometimes, but you have to contour it nicely, because it would be open either on the volar or on the dorsal side. So whenever you put a plate, it's not a straight plate. You have to contour it. in usually these plates are available with a bowler curvature, but you might have to do a kind of more templating and contouring, and that makes its utility a bit difficult. So I have been using K wires. You know, in adolescent we may use 3 wires, but wires are usually sufficient to give correction. And finally, transfix the distal radius and ulna. When ulna is quite dorsally subluxated, this volar radioulnar ligaments are lax. So you have to bring the ulna in position, put a wire, and by the time you remove the wire, this ligament will get fibrous and it will prevent it from going further out. So these are the technical tips I would like to give you while you are doing osteotomy. Now coming back to our case, so we did that ulna radial osteotomy correction and ulnar epiphyseoidosis. You can see that there is some positive ulnar variance, but patient was quite happy with the clinical correction. Her dorsal bump has gone and her range of motion has also normalized. So this child was 12 years old and we performed this procedure. Now there is a very good paper in JBJS 2013 from Texas Scottish Rite Hospital, with main author is Mary Beth Izaki, and they have published the results of volar ligament release and distal radial dome osteotomy for Madelung deformity. And a longer term follow-up, they have followed 27 patients for 25 years. An initial correction was very well maintained. Patients with worse preoperative radiologic parameters has higher risk arthritis score. So these parameters which I mentioned earlier, they have measured all those parameters. And the mesomelic patients, like our entire radius types, had increasing arthritic grades compared to the lower radius types. So again, this is worth explaining to parents at outset that surgery, even we do surgery, they may develop wrist arthritis, not because of the surgery, but because of the morphology of the disease. And 6 patients required further surgery. So what surgery they require? Either shortening of the ulna. So the now question is, which patients distal ulnar epiphyseoidosis should be done, and in which patient ulnar shortening osteotomy should be done? So there are gray areas, but this people from Boston Children's, Peter Waters and colleagues, they published this paper in JPO 2015, and they tried to retrospectively review their cases and try to study which are the radiologic parameters which can guide us for shortening of ulna and not ulnar epiphyseoidosis. What they have found, they performed ulnar shortening osteotomy for children more than 14 years of age or more than 22 millimeter palmar displacement of carpus after osteotomy, or more than 5 millimeter ulnar positive variance. So by and large, when children are grown up more than 14 years, your epiphyseoidosis are not going to give you correction. So you have to perform, and more severe radiologic parameters after osteotomy. Or once you do an osteotomy and it is not corrected well, then you have to do shortening. And when children between 10 to 14 years, they have suggested to do distal ulnar epiphyseoidosis. Now, at this point, you should also see the maturity of children, because we see many girls, they get matured pretty early in their life. So using this 10 to 14 years mark may not help, you know, and you might end up doing ulnar shortening procedure later on. So let's see this 15 years old girl, about a year post menarche. So she has finished her growth, and on the left side, she has ulnar prominence, and she had restricted wrist dorsiflexion, as you can see. And this is her x-ray, which you have seen previously. And there's an ulnocarpal crowding also. So what we have done, we resected the ligament, did the dome osteotomy of radius, and did ulnar shortening. Ulnar shortening was fixed with another wire, and distal radial ulnar joint was fixed with a transverse K wire. So this is how she did at 1.5 years follow-up. Her bump has resolved and her cosmetic correction and range of motion has improved. So this is her follow-up. One can see this ulnar inclination of radius has not significantly, I mean, there is still some inclination. One should correct it more aggressively, because residual inclination can lead to early arthritis. But there is a short-term follow-up. Her function and cosmetic outcome was good. So I have summarized this, or the protocol which we follow at OrthoKids is, the management depends on the patient's age, and we divide them below 10 years, 10 to 14 years, and more than 14 years. For less than 10 years, we do Vickers ligament release and physiolysis and just wait and watch. We explain to parents that some of these kids, about 15 to 20% of them, may need another surgery in future. And for children more than 14 years, we have to do the full Monty things, Vickers ligament release, dome osteotomy of radius, and ulna shortening. The problem or confusion appears when the children are between 10 and 14 years. Now, based on there, we take help of X-ray features. If they are very severely affected, then you have to do the Vickers ligament release and ulnar shortening. But the X-ray features are not severely affected, you can resort to just osteotomy, Vickers ligament release, and ulnar epiphysodesis. So this is in nutshell how we should treat Madelung deformity. I know there are some gray zones, and whenever you have doubt, you can ask family that we might need another set of operation. Rather than overdoing surgery, we had one child where we did ulnar epiphysodesis fairly early, and patient gradually developed ulnar negative variants. So that again, that is a difficult problem to deal with. So I think that finishes my talk, and we can discuss the question answers if you have. So I will kind of unmute people now.
Sir, can I ask one question, sir?
Yes. Those sir, they can put their mic and ask, and those want to present, I will let you share your screen also. Yes, Kaish sir, tell me.
So, how do you prefer epiphysiolysis in distal radius?
Kaish sir, can you come again? I could not hear, please.
So how do you perform epiphysiolysis in distal radius after operation?
Ligament release.
So Vickers ligament.
So it's not something very difficult, you know. It's once you release the Vickers ligament on IITV, you locate the most ulnar side of radial physis. Basically, on X-ray, you can see what part of physis is very narrow and from where the physis starts opening up, you know. And that part, I use dental burr to burr the physial part. And then I go right deep up to the middle center of the radius. So, because this tethering is mostly on the volar side, so you do the about half, and you don't have to go all across the dorsal surface of radius. So you do on the up to center, look at the lateral view, and the gap which is formed, you can take subcutaneous fat and put that fat there. I had seen Dr. Peter Waters doing this procedure in Boston, and before I could see, he finished it. So I said that it was very quick, and he said, you don't have to do much. You just burr it and put a fat graft and come out, and your surgery is done. So I think main thing is you take out the tether completely, and that decompresses that particular growth plate. And there are a few cases where we have seen we put a small wire to see whether that surgery is working or not. And as distal radius is a growing gland, it will show that that cut wire is progressing proximal. So yes, this is not very challenging. I think osteotomy correction, maintenance, putting those, that is more challenging than physiolysis.
Thank you, sir.
So this is, I think this is a nice surgery, and people, the parents and family are very happy. The only thing is this entire radius type, or the ones which with syndrome. I had a patient where I just did an epiphysiolysis, and they were not happy. Even though I have explained to them that your child might need an ulnar shortening later on, if But she finished her growth very fast, and so her ulnar was still ulnar was prominent. They were not happy that we need a second surgery on the child. So you have to explain that very clearly to family. So in bilateral cases, how do you stage other side after first hills or same sitting bilateral? So Amit came here once, Amit Nemade, and he assisted me in reverse Madlung. You know, what I have found is a typical Madlung have more satisfactory outcome because they have more cosmetic problem rather than functional problem. The reverse Madlungs, they have more functional problem. So if the patient is having, say, one side reverse and one side typical Madlung, I would do the typical Madlung first because that will make family more happy and they will come for the second surgery. But if there are bilateral Madlung, then we span the surgery for about 4 to 6 months because by the time the child would be will be ready and must be using the other side very freely. So we want their one limb is completely functional before we start operating on the other side. So I span them at 6 months. And the happy patients, they come asking for surgery. Unhappy patients, they don't turn up. Just like radio ulnar synostosis we see. Okay, any other question? Or if anyone else want to present their interesting case, I will let you share your screen.
Hi sir, good afternoon.
Hi Bansi, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Tell me.
I have a case.
You want to share?
Yeah. I have a PowerPoint presentation made already. So do I click on share screen?
Let me stop my sharing and how I can do that. Let me see. Stop share. Okay. So I have stopped sharing. Now try whether you can share it or not. See.
Host disabled participant screen sharing.
So I'll do it in a moment. Participants known. So, Kaisar, you have to guide me how I can let Bansi share his screen.
Sir, you just...
Yeah, tell me, Kaisar.
If what he just need to do is click on the share button and then... Sir, you need to make him co-host.
Ah, yes, multiple participants. Yeah, yes, Bansi, now you can share, I think. Right.
Yeah, yes. Can you see?
Yes, we can see now. Before you start, no, Amit Nemade had a comment that in older children, we should use plating. So I agree with you. And locked plates are available. The only thing is, you just cannot put your plate as it comes. You have to contour it because you want your osteotomy to be open volarly in Madlung and dorsally in the reverse Madlung. So yes, plates can be used. Yes, Bansi, you can share your case now.
Yes, sir. Is it visible?
Yes, we can.
So she's a 13-year-old female. She came with cosmetic deformity and pain while writing or pronation activities. So probably she was having impingement of ulnaris tendon, extensor carpi ulnaris. So if I have to palpate on it, she would complain of pain. Range of motion was fairly good. Only in severe pronation, it would hurt her. So this was the X-ray. This was the first X-ray in supination and then lateral. This after look, me being a new budding orthopod, after looking at the X-ray, I got scared a little bit first in supination. Then I got in pronation. So in pronation, I thought that I have some hope of correcting this. So operated. The thing is, currently there is lockdown going on. So they want to get these things corrected within lockdown instead of waiting for 6 months, as you mentioned. So they were like, you operate both on the first, on the same time in the same surgery. But I was hesitant of doing it because I have not done it previously. I had not even seen it. Only reading through papers and videos and online conferences. That's what I had heard about this. So I did it with a gap of 1 week. Because I thought right one was more severe than the left. The left one was more severe than the right one. So I took the more severe one first. So this is a weaker ligament intraoperative. And you don't see these things when you say fix adult radius, distal radius fractures. So it's a very novel band. It is very hard to miss, actually. So even when this was my first surgery, it was very hard to miss. After opening the supinator, you could just see it, and it was going right to the capsule, to the wrist capsule. So I excised it until I saw the lunate base, because this was specifically mentioned in a couple of papers that until and unless you see the lunate base, you don't stop. Even taking out a little bit of wrist capsule has not caused any subluxations, anything in their follow up. So I went ahead. Result right and left after a week. So clinically, I mean, radiologically it does not look very beautiful, but clinically it looked very nice. Another thing what sir mentioned about opening and closing wedge, Dr. Maulin Shah, you mentioned about opening and closing wedge. On SIAM, on IITV, the images are not that good to actually see if it is closing or opening. I mean, I could not really see it. So what I thought was, if you see the dorsal cortex, if you see that alignment of dorsal cortex with that itself, you can just fix a K wire. On this one of the X-rays, the K wire is not holding distal fragment at all. But then I was hesitant to remove it because it would. I was scared that I would move something.
Video is not.
So I just kept it there. So left, because it was a week apart and they were staying around 30-40 kilometers away. I did not want them to come twice, so they just came once. I removed. On the left side, I removed it, say, after around 38 days. This is the X-ray after 6 weeks of surgery. And this is fine. The one which I operated the first, the left side, it is fine. So this is the outcome. She's very happy about it. So in this, I had done the ulnar shortening because it was severe and I thought it was too much positive variance. Another thing about ulnar osteotomy is when you put a K wire and when you are trying to insert into the distal, into the proximal fragment, the distal fragment tends to rotate. So you need to hold it first with a cockers or a bone hold or something so that it does not rotate while inserting the K wire. However, on the other side, it was just 30 days when I removed the K wires. And yesterday she came with a deformity. So it was just 30 days since surgery. So I took her up today in OT and I could correct it. closed. And today at, I think at 1 p.m. I have done this around 1.5 hours ago. And I posted it. It looks fine, but I'll have to keep it again for another month or 40 days. So my, in this specific surgery, I thought I removed it too early and it again displaced. So as far as osteotomy is concerned, in addition to varus valgus, there is, I also think that you need some kind of supination, a rotational component and translation too. This will help in correcting the osteotomy rather than only angulating it. Some kind of translation. It is lateral translation and dorsal translation. It can be seen in these x-rays. There is dorsal translation and there is lateral translation with supination.
Yeah. So, Bansi, if you look at this x-ray, you know, for a typical Madlung, it's kind of reverse dome you have done.
Okay.
So it should be the other way. It should be a
other way.
Smiley, you know, and not a sad osteotomy. So there's a reverse thing. And once you do this, this smiley, your distal radius will easily go inside the proximal fragment. So the cortex of distal radius will align with the medulla of the proximal fragment. That itself makes it a stable osteotomy. At the same time, you can correct the ulnar inclination of radius better. That is one thing. And and if you start your wires from styloid process, then you can have good purchase. Again, as I mentioned, you don't try to be centered. And because if you are centered, then you cannot have good purchase in the proximal fragment. Okay. So that is one thing. Now, it's actually the three corrections we do. We correct the ulnar inclination, we translate it. And as we translate, the carpus comes in front of radius. And the sagittal deformity is also there. That's and sometimes, somehow, once we release the Vickers ligament, the osteotomy itself have a tendency of opening on the volar side. That's what I have seen. What we need to do is, once your wires are already there in the fragments, we confirm the alignment, and how we see is the metacarpal should be aligned with the proximal fragment. And and there, you have to keep it opened volarly a little bit. Most of the time, your assistant holding it, I have fellow, so I hold the reduction and assistants drive the wire home. So holding that reduction is very important. You pass one wire and you do not have much, you know, kind of trial and error. You don't want to poke many times because by doing that, that will become unstable or the distal fragment may get broken. So you want to have a very good hold and you confirm on both planes. You make your IRTV move.
Okay.
So, and that will help. So I think you do a reverse dome and your problem will be solved. And here in both the sides, I see that it's a kind of not a smiley, but it's a sad osteotomy. Somehow, you know, x-rays, they don't look good, but correction, their parents are happy.
Yes, and clinically it looked nice. Yeah. I mean, they were happy. Patients were happy.
And the other thing is, once I remove the wire, I give plaster for 3 more weeks. And once that is done, I see radiologic healing. For a few months, I use a Velcro fasten lightweight splint to hold the correction.
Okay.
Because if by chance the soft tissues are not corrected well, then this deformity may come back. And the bone may get refractured. So here there is periosteal reaction, but it's not completely united. So
it's
given way. Now you see the lateral view. See, your osteotomy here is opening dorsally. Now this is a typical Madlung. This should open volarly.
Volarly.
So if you have to correct it in sagittal plane, this should not open dorsally. It should open volarly.
Volarly.
So you should be able to see some gap when you have a volar approach. Yeah. For reverse MATLAB, you have to see on IITV, but for pure MATLAB, you can see under Vision that this is open. So, yeah, I think from next MATLAB, we have one posted next week. I will record the video and should send it across. But the last part is really tricky, how to hold osteotomy input wires. So I always have one trained assistant, you know, if my fellow is not around or he's on leave, I will ask one of my colleagues to come and help me in this case.
Okay.
Because this can go bad anytime. So, so that is what I've learned.
Yes. But one surprising thing was even after 40 days of primary surgery, I could still do this closed.
Yeah. So you could do the osteoclysis. That is very
yeah.
good.
I mean, I just moved it. I just from external force. I mean, I did not really do an osteoclysis. I did not put a K wire there in the fracture site. I mean,
that means that osteotomy has not kind of completely healed yet.
Not healed. Yes, yes. So I will continue plaster for another month.
So again, I'm seeing that now your radius is well aligned, but I want it overcorrected. You know. It should open on the, I see this thing,
okay.
but it is like well aligned.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so you keep it.
It should open up even more.
Yes, okay. because we have all structural right. deformity, it should open up.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, thanks. This was a nice case.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Plus for this.
Thank you. Sir.
Okay. Do we have any other case or questions from anyone? Okay, so if we don't have questions, then I would conclude this meeting. And we have, yes, Dr. Kishore, do you have any question?
No, sir, no question. That was excellent presentation.
Oh, thank you very much. So if you are interested in those articles, just WhatsApp to me and I will send those PDFs of those articles, right? There are some 7 to 8 articles which are really very good and worth reading. But none of the articles are mentioning practical tips which we should follow during surgery. So I have recorded this meeting and I'll put it on my YouTube channel or somewhere so you people can go through before you do your osteotomy. Okay. Take care. Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Mansi.
Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
We'll meet next week and we would have some other topic. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Bye.
Bye-bye.